Shall we wait for that?
Welcome to Curie Hospitals, where robotics enhances a human touch. Established in 2018, Curie is located on OMR at Thoraipakkam. Curie Hospital's design, built to NABH standards, is inspired not just by the need of its patients, but by the needs of their caregivers too. Which is why, as you walk into Curie, you will find every space ergonomically designed and environmentally inspired. A truly green experience. Curie is a 75-bed facility and one of Tamil Nadu's standalone single speciality hospitals for the treatment of renal diseases. What it means to be a single speciality hospital is that our expertise and focus is never diverted. All our facilities and staff are focused, trained, and dedicated to a single purpose, so that we can deliver the best possible medical care for your needs. Our hospital is designed to cater to all social strata economically, so that no patient will be denied excellent medical care at the time of need. But as the saying goes, a hospital is only as good as its doctor's skills. Which is why we are proud that we have specialists on board, singularly focused on our speciality, urology. To back up and support the skills of our specialists, Curie has the best cutting-edge technology available in all facilities, be it CT scans, ultrasound, urodynamics, dialysis, or just a simple X-ray, and of course, robotics. This ensures that every patient will get the best care with the best technology to back it up. Curie also has a plethora of the best qualified doctors who combine medical expertise with experience. What enhances this expertise is our new robotics technology, which adds a new dimension to assurance and reliability. Robotics in surgery increases better outcome for the patients, taking care and eliminating even small factors like a hand tremor. Curie has invested heavily in this new age technology, and the results have been remarkable. With a commendable success rate, we are already heading towards being a reckoning force in urology in India. Now let's step back a minute and think. Technology and skills apart, a hospital has to be about being humane, which is why our CSR program supports and houses the Indian Prostate Cancer Foundation and the Dementia Daycare Center, with specially designed spaces for both. A multi-cuisine canteen backed by inputs from our dietitians, and kiosks spread across every floor ensure patient comfort with a variety of food and caters to the need of their caregivers. Curie is committed to ensuring total comfort and care for its patients and caregivers. Curie, integrity and commitment towards patient care, backed by medical expertise. Curie, robotics with a human touch.
Thank you for the lovely video. Dr. N. Rajamaheshwari is the first gynecologist to qualify in urology in India and established the urogynecology specialty in our country. She rendered her medical services through the government Kasturba Gandhi Hospital, Chennai from 1982 till 2012. Subsequently, she is actively practicing, teaching and training medical fraternity gynecologists as well as urologists in urogynecology. Her mission is relieving the distress of women with urogynecological problems and improving their quality of life, with a vision that she works towards to ease the suffering of women who have these kind of urogynecological problems in developing countries. Her current designation is that she is a consultant urogynecologist at Curie Hospital and NRM Clinic. She is the director of the Urogynecology Research Center Private Limited, the president of the Urogynecology and Reconstructive Pelvic Surgery Society of India. She is the editorial board member of many journals, national and internationally. She is the member of the International Advisory Board for the Southern Asia and the Obstetrician and Gynecologist Association. She is a former professor of urogynecology and the head of department of the same department with the MMC. Welcome on board, Doctor. It is an amazing privilege for all of us women right after Women's Day to get this kind of information from such an experienced person like you, who could guide us through the various challenges that women face with health. The floor is all yours, Doctor. We'll all be on mute and we'd all ears to listen to you. Welcome, Doctor.
Thank you very much, Sheetal. Let's move to the program. Hello, I would like to check whether I'm audible. And is my screen seen?
Yes, ma'am, you are. It's audible and your screen is visible.
Okay.
Before starting, I would like to tell the audience one information.
Sure.
Dear participants, there will be a link which will be shared in the chat box. So after the session gets completed, I would request all to fill up that form. So it's basically a survey which is being collected. So I would request all the participants to fill those forms. Thank you. Ma'am, you can continue.
Also, ma'am, if the screen could be minimized a little, because we're not, I think, able to view the entire.
Can you see it now? Hello?
It's maximized, ma'am. It's enlarged. It's zoomed in completely. So only part of it is visible.
I think Dhanshagar, the IT person, because this is how we slide share our presentation.
Already you shared, you just click on.
Okay. Pardon?
Keep. 1 second.
You want me to click on the meeting controls?
Yes.
Mr. Dhanshagar, yes.
Yes, ma'am. Give.
Do you have the picture?
1 second.
Do you see the screen?
No, ma'am. You request remote control. Give.
See, from my end, I'm sharing my screen. Do you want me to stop share? Dhanshagar.
One second.
Okay.
Press F5.
F5, is it? Okay. F5, yes. This is how we normally slide share and do all our program.
1 second.
Shall I stop?
Stop and then.
Okay. Ma'am, yeah. Visible now, ma'am. Is it visible?
Yes, visible. Okay, yes. Right. Now I'm going to the full screen. Just let me know whether you can see. Okay. Do you see it now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am. Okay, perfect. Thank you. Thank you, Dhanshagar. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It is an honor and a privilege to be here with you all, and particularly to be part of Curie. And at the outset, I would like to thank the InnerVale Club members of Chennai Symphony and Curie Hospital for having organized this program. Dear ladies, we in our country, we face so many challenges. The challenges like population, illiteracy, diseases are common everywhere. But added on to it, we have the gender discrimination also in our country. See, there is a study published by Radha Devi about the status of women in India. It compares the working hours per year. A pair of ox works for 1,064 hours. A man works for 1,212 hours, whereas a woman works 3,485 hours per year. It is a clear case of exploitation, but if you look at it from the other point of view, I would deem it as indicating the strength of women in India. Ladies, we have more working women, more professionally qualified women, more female doctors, surgeons, scientists, professors, any number of women, talented women group you can see. It is true that they form the backbone of the family, society, nation, but at the same time, we neglect ourselves and there are so many social injustices too. So I'm going to tell you a story of a female child born and the baby grows, becomes comes to the pre-pubertal age, and then it becomes an adolescent, and then the reproductive phase comes, and then comes the menopause. From the beginning till the end, the woman's life is filled with shocks, surprises, and setbacks. Can you ever tell me what is the first shock of your life? I would say it is the onset of menstruation, which we call it as menarche, or the first time establishing the period. Even though it is a physiological phenomena like passing urine or passing motion, but there is so much of social taboo is attached to it. And then comes the period, that is the pregnancy and childbirth. It is women encounter countless mental and physical challenges in this period. And after finishing that comes the greatest setback in our life, that is the menopause. It is true that being a woman is a challenge, and that too in a country with a huge population of women. The current statistic says it is totally 66.3 crores. And with a high birth rate, the managing the health care needs of women in India is a great challenge. In that a context, I would like to congratulate Curie for having taken up this project of managing the urogynecological problems in Curie Institute. And I thank and congratulate Gayathri, Anthakrishnan, and Professor Sivaraman for having taken the trouble to establish everything. Ladies and gentlemen, I am a urogynecologist. What do I do? What cases do I manage? I tackle women with problems like disorders or dysfunction of the lower urinary tract and genital tract. So you all can recall from your past memory that we all have the uterus, vagina, we have the tubes and the ovaries, which all form the genital system. And we have the urinary system, that is the kidneys, ureter, and urinary bladder. As urogynecologists, we deal with problems of uterus and the lower urinary tract, the bladder, urethra, and to an extent to the rectum and the anal canal problems. Ladies and gentlemen, considering the time constraint, it is impossible for me to elaborate on all the problems a woman can encounter from the time of birth till the end. So I'm just going to enumerate the problem. So first, if you take the pre-pubertal age, from birth to pubertal age, she will be there in the pre-pubertal phase. So you will have vulvovaginitis and developmental anomaly related problems, urinary incontinence, urinary infection, so on and so forth. And moving to the reproductive period, mainly problems related to the menstrual periods, like polycystic ovarian disease, and the profuse bleeding, intermenstrual bleeding, endometriosis, pregnancy, delivery-related problems, or tumors in the uterus. Benign tumors rarely, cancer also can occur, and prolapse uterus. All these are the common gynecological problem. This is the picture just showing you some of the fibroid tumors, benign tumors which can occur in a woman's uterus. And similarly, if you see, we have the pelvic organs in our body. This is the bladder, which stores the urine and the urethra. And you have the uterus and the vagina. You have the rectum and the anus. All these structures are very well supported by the pelvic floor muscles, ligaments, and everything. When these supporting structures get damaged by childbirth or by inherent tissue weakness or by repeated operations or because of hormone deficiency, you get these organs cannot be retained in their original position within the body, and they come down like this. You can see the bladder has come down like this, the uterus has come down, and even the intestine has come down. This is what we call it as prolapsed uterus. Ladies and gentlemen, most of this problem are related to childbirth related trauma. See, you see, this is how the pelvic floor muscles and ligament and fascia keeps the organs within the pelvis, like very well supported, and there is absolutely no descent. But once you see, when the child comes out, all these structures are damaged, and that leads to so many problems. Importantly, one is the prolapse, that is the descent of uterus or bladder or motion passage, or urinary incontinence. Even one pregnancy and one childbirth is enough to cause urinary incontinence. And as the number of childbirth increases, the chances of developing prolapsed uterus is much higher. Ladies and gentlemen, there are other urological problems in the reproductive phase, the stress urinary incontinence, overactive bladder, and other urethral stricture causing obstruction to the urinary flow. And like in man, we also can have stone disease, tumors, infection, all those things. And what is this? This is the stress urinary incontinence, which is very, very common in women. That is, when the supporting structures are defective, if she coughs or laughs, the urine will leak. And what is this overactive bladder? Normally, bladder can hold nearly 500 ml of urine, but in overactive bladder, it's 100 ml or 150 ml, even much less than that, the bladder will contract. That will result in frequency, urgency, and the woman has to run to the bathroom. So let us move over to the postmenopausal period. In the postmenopausal period, again, mainly the prolapse condition, infections, incontinence, and more of the tumors and more of cancers, uterus, ovaries, vaginal, vulval, all these can affect. And the prolapse is very, very common in the late reproductive period and in the postmenopausal women. Similarly, urinary infection and incontinence can happen at any age, but it is much worse, much more common in the postmenopausal women. Again, because of the hormone deficiency, there is likely to be urinary infection, urethral narrowing, and all other situations. Ladies and gentlemen, I just would like to state few basic facts about urine. I know this program is organized by the Cutting Edge Technology Institute with the Robo, but still it is worth knowing the basics. See, normally, how many times a lady can pass urine? During daytime, from morning till she goes to sleep, it is normal to pass urine 6 to 7 times. And during nighttime, once she sleeps, it is acceptable to pass urine once or twice. If it is any time more than that, it is abnormal. Similarly, the urine volume in 24 hours expected to be 2 to 2.5 liters in 24 hours. Similarly, the color of the urine should be clear, like water, it should be. See, in this side, you can see an yellowish urine. This yellowish urine may be because the urine was stored for a long time overnight and emptied in the morning, or maybe the patient has consumed B-complex or pyridium or some of the medicines which can color the urine. If these factors are excluded, when you find an yellow urine, one should think of the possibility of jaundice. See here, this urine is not at all clear. It is turbid, and it is stained with pus. So this kind of pyuria, we call it, this can happen when there is a stone problem in the kidneys or in the urinary tract or in the bladder, or sometimes when there is obstruction in the urinary tract and with special infection like tuberculosis, which can damage the kidney and can produce what is called a pyonephrosis, for which we have to remove this affected kidney. Similarly, sometimes the urine can be buttermilk-like or milk-like, or sometimes even blood-stained and look like this. This condition is called chyluria, and this is nothing but, it is not cancer, but it is nothing but the obstruction in the lymphatics which are draining the kidneys, and because of the obstruction, the chyle gets drained and gets mixed with the urine. That's why you get this. And the next is blood-stained urine. Blood, red, is a red alert sign. So this red urine or blood-stained urine can happen in any number of conditions. It can happen in urinary infection. It can happen in stone disease. It can happen in renal parenchymal disease. It can happen with the trauma to the urinary tract. But what one should remember is, when there is a blood-stained urine, you should always think of the possibility of a cancer in the urinary tract. What you see in this picture is a bladder growth, and you can also, this is a tumor in the kidney which was responsible for the blood-stained urine. So one should, when the red alert, when you get that, you always think of the possibility of cancer. Then it is a pity to know that our women who have cancer in the mouth of the uterus, we call it as cancer cervix, and because the disease silently kills the people, it just progresses without much symptoms, and it spreads anteriorly and infiltrates into the bladder, and because of that, the patient will present to you with the blood in urine. But in fact, it is an advanced cancer of the uterus. So dear ladies, I would like you to remember the fact that if you take the world cancer cervix population, and up to 29% of all cancers are contributed, cervical cancer is contributed by our Indian women. That is a pity. And it says that more than 200 women die every day because of cancer cervix. And every 7 minutes, one Indian woman die of cancer cervix. So I think it is high time we all just think of this, and we have to take steps. See, what is important to know is, it is a preventable cancer. You can very easily diagnose cancer cervix in the early stages. It is caused by the human papilloma virus. It spreads by sexual transmission. There is a simple tool called the pap smear. Throughout your reproductive phase and in the postmenopausal period, you need to visit your local gynecologist and get the simple pap smear test once in every 3 years. And that itself will help you to detect if there is any cancer changes in the cervix. And early treatment carries very good prognosis. And above all, vaccination is very effective, but it is you should start it before the sexual activity begins in a woman's life. So what is quite disheartening is to know is that every woman is at risk of cervical cancer. How? It says that up to 80% of women acquire the HPV infection in their lifetime. The risk of oncogenic infection is high even after single intercourse, and it continues throughout the women's sexually active life. So ladies and gentlemen, it is worth knowing that there is a cumulative risk of 46% of acquiring the cervical human papillomavirus infection even with one sexual partner. And normally it happens 3 years after the first sexual encounter. So is there a vaccine? Yes. And that how should the vaccine be given? You have to give the 3 doses of vaccine. You can start right from the 9th year of age, and 0, 2, and 6 months. And it is effective provided you start it very early, before the sexual life begins. But even then, it can be given throughout up to the age of 45, because this virus causes not only cancer, it also causes the HPV-induced warts and infections. And this vaccination certainly can prevent the woman from all these things. And this is the latest quadrivalent vaccine, and it prevents cervical, vulvar, vaginal cancer, precancerous dysplastic lesions. It prevents the genital warts and infections. Ladies and gentlemen, it is true that this vaccination should be given to men too, right from 9 to 25 years, because that will protect them from the genital warts and other infections associated with the human papilloma virus. So this virus, this vaccination against the HPV virus is safe and effective. And throughout the world, World Health Organization, Food and Drug Administration, CDC, they all have declared that this vaccination is safe and effective. Ladies and gentlemen, how can you keep yourself free from cancer cervix? One is vaccination, another is screening. That is periodical screening every 3 years. So either you have the simple pap smear test, or you can have the pap smear and the HPV test. And it is recommended using condoms during sex can prevent HPV infection. In the screening, you have the pap smear, liquid-based cytology, HPV testing, and even visual screening like colposcope and colposcope-directed biopsy. Ladies and gentlemen, a word about the other number one cancer killer among women. First is the cancer breast. Next only comes the cancer cervix. What to do for the cancer breast? You need to clinically do the self-examination periodically. In women who are at high risk, should go through the periodical mammogram examination. Let's move to the urogynecological problem, that is the pelvic floor dysfunction, incontinence, and other things. So it is a hidden epidemic in the sense more than 50% of women beyond the age of 35, they have the urogynecological problems. I am going to discuss about few types of incontinence and the urinary tract infection. So what is incontinence? It is not just occasionally having few drops of leaking urine. It is an involuntary loss of urine, which is demonstrable and which has social and hygienic consequence. That is the International Continence Society's definition. So how common it is? If you take 3 women, 2 out of 3, they have urinary incontinence. It is highly prevalent worldwide, and it is twice more common in women compared to men. And it is much more common in elderly women. So even though there are different types, I'm just going to talk to you about the urge incontinence and stress incontinence. These are the risk factors for a woman, a multiparous woman, and or menopausal women, or all these high risk factors, when they are there, they are at risk of developing urinary incontinence. So it is not a life endangering problem. Nobody is going to die of urinary incontinence, but it causes physical and psychological disturbances. So it affects their social life, their sexual life, their occupational life, and so on. So ladies and gentlemen, let us first see the overactive bladder. So what I told you that this bladder contracts early, even when there is less than 200 ml of urine in the bladder. So what really happens is the kidney secretes urine continuously. It gets drained by the tubes and it is stored in the bag called the urinary bladder. So worldwide, 12.2 million adults have urge incontinence. And as usual, it is more common in women, and it is more than 50% of women, they also have stress incontinence and overactive bladder. What are the symptoms with this kind of overactive bladder? Mm-hmm. They will have frequency, urgency, nighttime increased frequency, and urge incontinence. So up to 80% will have frequency, increased frequency, in urgency, nocturia, and incontinence. Even many of them even report coital incontinence. Ladies and gentlemen, I already told you 6 to 7 is normal frequency, but women with the overactive bladder will pass more frequently, and nighttime more than once or twice will be nocturia, and that will be very typical in overactive bladder. And they will have a strong, sudden desire to urinate, and they cannot resist the urge to pass urine. They have to run, and invariably they will wet themselves before reaching the toilet. So have you ever wondered why women keep their legs crossed? You know that your grandmother will say, keep your legs crossed. And we never question them why they are asking us to cross their legs like this. Have you seen women now crossing always? Yes, because it is one way of clever way of trying to contain the urinary leakage. So regarding the etiology of the overactive bladder, it can be myogenic or psychogenic, or it can be due to pelvic floor urethral factors. And women who have stroke problem, those who have Parkinson's disease, those who have multiple sclerosis or spinal cord damage will have a neurogenic overactive bladder. We need to thoroughly evaluate them to exclude all these factors. And if necessary, we have to do the urodynamic function assessment and then plan the treatment. We have the drugs, we have bladder training, we have, the drugs fail, we have the intradecrous or Botox injection, if needed, even surgical measures. It is true, this bladder, overactive bladder, can call the shots. It may drag you away from your routine work. You cannot hold yourself. There is no need for you to suffer with all these things. There are excellent medications available now, and definitely 90%, over 90% of women can be helped with this medication. What are the barriers? We always feel embarrassed to discuss the problem, and we presume that the treatment may not help. And these are the barriers. I think one has to break that barrier and take the medication along with bladder training. Then that will help our patients up to 80%. There are also special incontinence pads available, and that will help them. In a very low percentage of affected patients, if they're not responding to a medication, we go in for the other invasive procedures like Botox injection or neuromodulation or cystoplasty. Ladies, next I will talk about the stress urinary incontinence. When I say stress urinary incontinence, it doesn't mean nothing to do with mental stress. It is the physical stress. That is, any physical exertion like coughing, laughing can result in sudden leakage of urine. So not necessarily it happens only in a weightlifting champion like that. If you lift such a heavy weight, you will leak. It is not like that. Even a small exertion, like even playing, exercising, carrying the baby, heavy weight, all these things can happen. How common is this stress urinary incontinence? If you take 4 women with urinary incontinence, 3 out of them will have stress urinary incontinence. What is the cause? The cause for stress incontinence and prolapse uterus will be more or less the same. the pregnancy, childbirth related trauma, multiple childbirth, multiple pelvic operations, hormone deficiency, obesity, high impact activities, chronic cough, all these can result in stress urinary leakage. How do we manage? If it is not disturbing your day-to-day activity, we will definitely recommend only a conservative modality. So women who have not completed their childbearing role, or who want to postpone surgery, or who are not fit for surgery, or if they have complications like voiding problem, then we just recommend them with conservative modalities. So what is that we recommend? We just recommend lifestyle intervention, fluid management, pelvic floor muscle training, etc. This is a very good exercise, provided it is learned in a proper manner and practiced according to the method. And it has to be started right from the school going age and continued throughout the life. Then it will be very effective. You can do it with biofeedback or without it. Or you, the vaginal cones and electrical stimulation can help you to learn the pelvic floor exercise. What is the disadvantage with it? You can't expect a fast success with this. And over time, the compliance declines. And people will stop doing exercises. So that is the reason it is not so very popular. If the conservative modalities fail, or if the problem progresses, then we resort to what is called the operations. There are operations much more advanced than laparoscopic techniques, like minimally invasive tech sling operations are available, which can be effective, provided you use your discretion in choosing the patient. And it is true, most of our patients will have stress urinary incontinence as well as urge incontinence. So, and this combined problem, one should be aware, and we need to be aware, because the urge incontinence is a problem of the bladder, whereas the stress incontinence is the problem of the urethra. So they have a different etiology and they have a different treatment. But only thing is, they can coexist in the same person. So you have to treat the predominant element which is bothering the patient. Next is, as I told you already, incontinence can happen in any age, but it is affecting more the elderly women. It was twice more in older women. So it is show you how the social ostracization can happen in the old age home. And people can, you see, these are not the regular chairs, they are commodes. And the day is not far away if this problem is not taken care and managed properly. Ladies and gentlemen, the next problem, which is the outcome of childbirth, is the prolapse uterus. So mainly the childbirth trauma, but very rarely other inherent weakness, chronic cough, repeated heavy lifting, overweight, all these things can result. Initially, it can be just a small, something like an egg or a balloon coming, causing the bulge symptoms, pressure effects, etc. Or subsequently, the patients may have problem in passing urine, passing motion, or even walking. So any size, any duration containing any number of organs can present as prolapse. And we have a reconstructive operative procedures available, minimally invasive, to the extent even a robotic reconstruction is possible in women who have this kind of prolapse uterus. Next, the summer has already come. What is next in pipe is the urinary tract infection. It is said that there can never be a lady who has not experienced urinary tract infection in her lifetime. It is true. It's a most common problem in women. So what is this? It is just the microorganism spreading and causing the inflammatory response of the lining of the bladder or the urinary tract. So again, if you see, it is more common in women and it increases with increase of age. So why is this? Why are women vulnerable for urinary infection? Because women have a very short urethra and the anus is very close by, vagina is very close by. You see the perianal region and perivaginal region is colonized with organisms which can very easily move to the urethra and cross the short urethra and cause the urinary tract infection. So being a female is a risk factor. And of course, there are other factors. And there is a special blood group, P1 blood group. Those women who have it, they are highly vulnerable to develop the urinary tract infection. So women in the postmenopausal age group, mainly because of the hormone deficiency, hypoestrogenism, they suffer from the urinary tract infection. So urinary tract infection is a spectrum of problem. There can be lower tract infection like cystitis, urethritis, involving only the bladder or the urethra, which is much more common. And there also can be a severe form affecting the kidney, resulting in what is called the pyelonephritis, urosepsis, shock, and other things. And sometimes there can be even be asymptomatic bacteriuria. Sometimes even in pregnancy, one can encounter urinary tract infection. But the very common presentation is women presenting with dysuria, frequency, urgency, pain in the lower abdomen, sometimes very rarely even blood-stained urine. So you need to evaluate the women, particularly when they develop recurrent urinary infection. So you need to do the urine analysis, urine microscopy examination, urine culture, and treat them. But in those women who have the kidney infection, the symptoms will be very virulent and they will have flank pain, fever with rigor, vomiting, and tenderness in the body. All those symptoms, even to the extent of having septic shock. So they need a very prompt and invasive treatment. How do they get the urinary infection? Usually it is the E. coli. Up to 85% of the E. coli is responsible for causing the infection. And how do they spread? As I told you earlier, it is the ascending spread usually, but it can spread by the blood and the lymphatic road. And you can see how nicely this uropathogen can ascend from the urethra into the bladder, then to the ureter and even the kidney. So what is very important is, it is not all those patients who have urinary infection need CT scan or MRI. One should start evaluating with simple tests like urine analysis, urine microscopy, urine culture. And if the patient has recurrent infection, when we say recurrent infection, what we mean is within 6 months, if they develop more than two urinary tract episode, or in 1 year, if they develop more than 3 episodes, then we say it is recurrent infection. These women will have thorough evaluation to exclude whether there is any upper tract anomalies and other things. Next, I'm going to talk to you about simple good bladder habits. What are they? There are 5 steps in this. What is this? We should take proper, appropriate fluid intake. So 6 to 8 glasses of water every day one should take. So that is very important. So those women who have urinary leakage problem, they tend to decrease the intake of the fluid. If they decrease it, the urine will become concentrated and that itself will irritate the bladder and worsen the symptoms. So one should not restrict the fluid intake. You should take the fluid to the extent that you produce at least 2 liters of urine in 24 hours. So if you are a sports person and your physical activity is at a high level, you need to take more fluid. So if the patient has a cardiac failure or renal failure, one should not take excessive fluid. So the behavioral recommendation is, somebody has urinary infection, they should increase their fluid intake and frequently empty their blood. Because when you frequently empty, then along with the urine, the organisms also will be void. And if someone who has urinary incontinence problem, please restrict your fluid intake before going to bed. So avoid drinking caffeine or lot of fluid before doing exercise, before going to gym. Know that otherwise your frequency will be more disturbing your activity. So it is a general rule that one should reduce the consumption of caffeine or the carbonated beverages. And there are food items which can irritate the bladder, like spicy food, oranges, tomatoes, they can cause irritation of the bladder. And certainly alcoholic drinks will cause polyuria, and that will make you visit the bathroom frequently. One tip, hygienic tip is, when you wash yourself or when you clean yourself after passing urine, you need to clean from front to back, because if you do it from back to front, the motion particles at the back may come and soil in the periurethral region. So that is one tip that you need to teach all your children at home. And second is, when children, they pass urine, please make sure they spend adequate time, empty their bladder completely. And there is no need to go to the bathroom just in case, because if you go on be emptying too frequently, the bladder capacity will be diminished. So, and in the most important thing that the female children should learn is to relax and void completely. A position like this with a stool, simulating something like a squatting position is much preferable than the other position. And the next one is, one should maintain a good bowel habit. So you see, this is the bowel impacted with feces, and this can block the bladder neck and urethra and cause urinary retention. So you should have regular bowel movement, increase the fiber content, and see that you see how nicely the bowel is here. And you see here how the impacted bowel blocks the urethra. So you increase the fiber content, see that you don't have the constipation. Dear ladies, it is said size and shape doesn't matter. Well, it matters here. You see, if the weight is more, the obesity will add additional stress on the pelvic floor muscles. You need to suggest your patients to lose weight. And next comes the bladder training. What is this? See, a Chinese proverb says, bladder is the window to the soul. You know, we have so many involuntary organs in our body. One is the heart, which you just now saw. So the heart, it will go on be beating without our control. But the bladder is also an involuntary organ, but you can train your bladder, you can tame your bladder, and you can tackle the problem. So that's how the bladder training is going, how you train the children at the age of 3 years, how do you do the toilet training like that. Even in an adult, you can do the urge suppression bladder training, and that can help the patients who have overactive bladder. So next is the pelvic floor exercise. I was telling you earlier how women with stress urinary incontinence and women who have early stages of prolapse will have improvement if they practice the pelvic floor muscle exercise. So you need to sit in a chair, slightly lean forward, and then try to mimic the act of passing motion or urine. And once you are doing, you are contracting the pelvic floor muscles. You see, the pelvic floor muscles are like this. So these are the muscles and ligaments supporting the bladder, vagina, uterus, and the motion passage. Bladder, uterus, vagina, and the motion passage. So it is like a hammock. So these muscles, when they get relaxed, weakness acquired by childbirth or neurogenic or due to operations, they let the organs come down or they let the urine come out. So you need to strengthen this group of muscles. So it is very important to learn the exercise, strengthen the muscles, and compliance is very, very important. One should continue it. Certainly it will help in your life in all future occasions. Dear ladies, I would like to conclude by saying there is a Spanish proverb which says, 6 men give a doctor less to do than 1 woman. So it is true. So first, I would like you to remember that there is a dreadful condition called cervical cancer, which is the second most common killer, cancer killer of women. And you can prevent this, this cancer by vaccination. You can do early detection of this cancer by simple tests like pap smear. And do remember this, if you have women and children at home, please remember to vaccinate them. Please request them to go for periodical screening of with this simple test. And second is urge incontinence, a dreadful condition. It is not cancer. It is only the sensation to pass urine, which you cannot resist it. So it is a social problem for women. It can be treated and improved. And then there is no need that women should silently endure this problem. And the pelvic organ prolapse is a very common thing. It can happen to women who have delivered children, and it is surgically curable. And those women who have stress urinary incontinence, certainly they will improve with pelvic floor muscle exercise. And if it fails, we can certainly help them with a simple advanced operative techniques like slings. So urinary tract infection, certainly you can. It is a treatable problem, even though only to a smaller extent you can prevent the urinary tract infection. So I would like to thank you. But before ending, I request you, I'm prepared to, if you have questions, I'm prepared to answer. And I also request you to participate in a small questionnaire survey. It will just take a couple of minutes for you to reply, because we always lack data. So we really don't know where exactly we stand. So just to know where do we stand, please visit this and give you participate in the survey, and let me have your valuable reply. Thank you very much. And I stop the lecture, but I'll be available for you to take any questions.
Thank you, Doctor, for the amazing presentation, information, and understanding of women's health challenges that all of us face. We had a question in the chat, if I may just read it from there. It was regarding the vaccination for cervical. It says that, is it a must to take the vaccination? So what would you like to say, Doc?
I think it is recommended to have the vaccination, because it is not that all women in the world are going to develop cancer cervix, but we don't know who will develop, who will not develop. Okay, so I already told you that there is a cumulative risk of 46% of acquiring this HPV infection. So if I have a sister, if I have a daughter, if I have a granddaughter, I will certainly recommend them to have the vaccination.
Right.
Have I answered the question?
Yes, I think so, Doc. Doctor, one more question. Kegels. Is it what it's called? The pelvic floor muscle exercises?
Exactly, Sheetal. Yes.
Yes. So somebody has asked whether there is any limit, and when is it that we should stop doing it?
See, there is no limit. Stop doing it. When should you start doing it? So you should start doing it right from the school going days. But it is very difficult to make the school-going child to see reason in doing the pelvic floor exercise, because they won't be in an age to understand the significance of it. And they may not be well motivated to continuously practice it. So, but you can try doing it as early as possible in the science. Any age, which they are aware and they are willing to do the exercise, let them do the exercise. The other name is the Kegels exercise. But what is important, everybody imagine that they are doing exercise when they don't. When they exercise the abdominal muscles, when they exercise the respiratory muscles or gluteal muscles, it will not help. You need to exercise the pelvic floor muscles. You need to have the guidance of the doctor or a trained physiotherapist. It is just a 15 minutes in the morning, 15 minutes in the afternoon, and 15 minutes in the evening. So no need to allocate separate timings. As you are talking to me, as you are watching a TV, as you are reading a book, you can do it. Just sit, slightly lean forward. Imagine that you are passing urine or motion. Just stop interrupting the act of passing urine or motion. That will cause the contraction of the pelvic floor muscles. Keeping the muscles contracted, count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. While you're counting, the muscles should be in the contracted state.
Okay.
Once the five number is reached, then you can relax. Okay. Then contract, count, relax. Contract, count, relax. So this should go on for 15 minutes. But it may sound funny now, but as you start doing it, it will be much easier for you to practice it. So not simply doing once or twice or for 1 month or a couple of months, it should be continued. That is the important
thing. Yes, doctor. So we have one more question. Is it possible to have sudden severe UTI with blood and urine without any earlier symptoms? What if it happens only once in 3 or 4 years? Can it be ignored, or how does it go by?
I think, if it is once in 3 years, if it is a severe symptom with blood stained, okay, definitely I would like to evaluate myself first with the urine culture test and the basic blood test. And then I will have a simple ultrasound screening of the kidney bladder area. If there is any abnormality, then I will proceed with the further evaluation.
Yes, doctor. Another person would like to know, after 50, should one avoid running and skipping to avoid prolapse?
So I think one should do their day-to-day activities. Like, I think minimum walking should be permitted irrespective of the age. Because if you don't walk, then the chances of us developing diabetes and other things are much higher. A problem in the elderly women is, they may have some kind of arthritis, they may have difficulty in running or skipping. So it is not that by skipping that the uterus is going to calm down. If the uterus is that much weak, if that support is that much weak, even the walking will result in prolapse. Okay, so yes, that can't be helped.
Yes, okay. Doctor, one more question. HPV vaccination first dose at the age of 9 is okay?
9 is okay. If because you are not aware, if you have not given, even if it is 12, 13, 14, 15, don't hesitate to give the vaccine.
And
even after the marriage, after say somebody is 30 years and the only they came to know about the vaccination now, please don't hesitate to give the vaccination, because if not the cancer, it will help protecting the other causes, the other problems of HPV infection, like the precancerous lesions, warts, and infections. Okay, so yes, till up to the 45 years, up to from 9 years up to 45 years, and this vaccine can be given, but it will be more effective if the vaccine is given prior to the onset of sexual life.
Yes, doctor. And the upper age group to have HPV, can it be done after 50? Would it be any help?
Oh, actually, the recommended upper age limit is 45. Okay. And it is said that it is not going to help more after that.
Okay. What about gynecological and urological clinical examinations after 50? How often should that be done?
Certainly. See, this after 40 years, and you know, like you all recommend that you should have the health examination. Okay, see once in say 2 years, 3 years, we recommend them to go through, you check your BP, check your cholesterol, check your blood sugar, all those things. Like that, you should have your breast examination. You should, I already told you, right from the age of 30 onwards, certainly, everyone should have a pap smear every 3 years. And in high risk cases, even if necessary, even the HPV test is required. So the health examination is a must. There is no limit that you should do the health examination only after 50, only after 60 or 70. So if you can have the health examination, it is better. Even if you're 40, you have your regular health examination. It's for your own safety.
Absolutely. And we have somebody who says any yoga like Supta Vajrasana will strengthen your uterus muscles. I don't know if they're asking or telling, but we will
see. I'm not well versed with the yoga thing, but only thing is I can tell you, if that yoga exercise is going to strengthen your pelvic floor muscles, it is worth adopting it. Because we say it as Kegels exercise and they call it in a different name. If it is going to strengthen the same group of muscles and other supporting structures, definitely it is worth using it.
Yes. I think we've covered almost all the questions, unless that anybody else wants to type in any other question. Somebody wants to know if it's possible to share the slides of the seminar for them to forward it to their or any of your YouTube channels if it has this information, so that they could forward it to their other
sisters, mothers. I will share it. Yes, I'll do that.
And also the link for the survey has not been shared. So if it could be shared again right now.
Yeah, I'll do that right now.
Yes, please. Thank you so much.
They will post you the link, or they'll put it in your chat section.
Absolutely.
And it is a humble request from my side. Please, ladies, all of you, participate in this simple questionnaire survey. And that will be of great use for us to know where our women stand with reference to these problems, so that we can plan strategy, a management protocol for them.
Yes, sure, doctor. Ladies, the link is already on the chat, so please do the needful. And we'd like to close this session here, before which I think we should hand over it to this secretary of Inner Wheel Club of Chennai Symphony, Soumya Shankar. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Sheetal. On behalf of IWC Chennai Symphony, I would like to thank our club members, members from other clubs, our friends and family who took the time to attend the meeting. I also would like to thank Mrs. Gayatri Anandakrishnan from Curie Hospital, Dr. Raja Maheshwari, for this wonderful informative session, whole management team at Curie Hospital, and our friend Rama Rajesh, to have made this session a big success. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much, Soumya. And I would like to thank, on behalf of Curie team, the Inner Wheel Clubs of Chennai Symphony, the president, Mrs. Kavita Srinivas, and the secretary, Soumya Shankar, and Dr. Raja Maheshwari, share her experience and knowledge on the urogynecological department. So anyway, I wish all the participants a happy Women's Day, and let's end the session. So soon we'll be sharing the link as well, the YouTube link, to all the members for today's sessions. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you, doctor. Thank you, Curie Hospital.
Yeah, it was very wonderful, doctor. Thank you so much.
Thank you.